Hello friends, welcome to the EduSite Network. Our today's topic of discussion is under our series on writing in India, and we're today discussing Lal Ded's poetry as part of our Women Bhakti Poets. We have already discussed Meera, we have had two lectures on her, and today is our introductory, our lecture on Lal Ded. And for this discussion, we have with us in our studio Dr. Anand Prakash, retired professor of English Literature, University of Delhi. He has a teaching experience of more than 4 decades, and he has been associated with us in this series and previous ones as well. So with this, I would like to welcome sir and request him to begin our today's lecture.
Thank you, Urvashi, and welcome viewers to this discussion on Lal Ded. The name may not sound familiar because this name doesn't come from North India or Central India. It comes from the extreme north, that is Kashmir. And Kashmiri tradition, a very rich cultural tradition, is not as well known to the normal Indian reader as it should be, because Kashmir has been a source of great literary traditions and achievements. And apart from literary and cultural, Kashmir has been a center of what I call mysticism, mystical thought and philosophy. And most of the pundits and others in Kashmir, they were well read, they were well versed in different languages, and they were confronting right from the beginning of the first millennium, they were in touch with diverse opinions, and people from all parts of the world came and interacted with the Kashmiris, and the Kashmiris also gave something back to the people who came to meet them, and the kind of cross fertilization that is supposed to occur in the human domain, that was quite well pronounced in Kashmir, which means that in Kashmir there is not that kind of orthodoxy, there is not that kind of intolerance for the other's opinion as there might be in some other parts of the country. So to this rich tradition belongs Lal Ded herself, a woman poet, a saint. And so far as the time is concerned, she belongs to the period still earlier than both Kabir and Meera. Kabir was there in the 14th, 15th centuries, Meera was there in the 16th century, and Lal Ded, this great woman, was there in the 14th century. Since I've been teaching, English literature, so straight away I convert, the time frame into the English time frame. And when I read the dates of her, birth, there are two dates of her birth. One is 1330, the other is 1335. Then I straight away, went to the birth year of Chaucer, and his birth year was 1340 or 1344. So there is a gap of just 5 or 10 years between the two poets, and we have this poet, talking of something which will start a kind of chain reaction in the whole of India. She's talking of telling people what the relationship is with God, what is the relationship with morality, what is more than that, what is their relationship with the world in which they live, and the philosophical question of who they are. All this is important. And being from Kashmir, Lal Ded is not given to that kind of celebration which is associated with Meera in North India. She's a very engaged, serious, philosophical kind of a figure, a person who wants to know, who wants to learn, and who is earnest in her tone. And there's no celebration, there's no love, there's nothing like the great happy moments of life. She's all the time asking herself questions, serious questions of existence, and she's asking questions from others also, and it's a kind of common pursuit so far as you know her, her discussions and her you know statements that come in her poetry. So why? Why is it that her poetry is so very serious and intent? The reason may be, as I already indicated, that the orientation of the Kashmir mind is the philosophical orientation. And secondly, there is always a give and take between different philosophical opinions and stands. And she is a true inheritor of these two, kinds of life, that exist in Kashmir from the beginning of that millennium. So maybe these are the reasons, and that people have traced references to Shaivism. Now Shaivism in India is not as popular perhaps as Vaishnav thought, but then people who believed in prehistory more than others, because Shiva is Lord Shiva is a figure is a god figure in the Indian pantheon. And he belongs to still an earlier period. If you have the fixed in your mind, I have fixed in my mind, for instance, the figure of Shiva, who is a yogi, who has closed his eyes, who has snakes around his neck, who has a third eye also. When he's angry, then the third eye is open. So all these things relate to far back in history, and then since he's a yogi. Therefore, he will have a different kind of impact on his audience, and there is a Shiva thought, and there are of course large number of Shaivites in India, and they are different from the Vaishnavas who belong to the Brahmanical tradition, rituals and orthodoxy, and Shaivites who believed in concentration on certain things and principles, and who would be more natural in the responses, and of course ascetics of a different kind, then going into the rituals of religion. So Shaivism is one important strand in Kashmir thought. The other important strand that had a direct relationship with Lal Ded was that Muslims in India. Now this goes against the entire historical perception of the presence of Muslims in India. Muslims in India, so far as Kashmir is concerned, came very early before the supposed invasions began. For instance, in the 8th century, 9th century, you have Muslim saints and others who come to Kashmir, who also come to India. And it is these, who want to learn from India and who want to teach people from India. So this philosophical give and take that is happening at the hands of Muslims and Hindus at that point of time is quite significant. Particularly for a poet like Lal Ded, who wants to learn, who wants to tell people what should be done, what should not be done, and how the world goes on. So all these things, the Shaivism, and the third thing is the Kashmiri thought itself, which has evolved over the centuries. So Shaivism came from outside, the Muslim thought came from, Mohammedan thought came from outside, and Kashmir had their own experience, their own literature, their own traditions. So all these three things, combined. In the 8th and 9th centuries, and they continued evolving naturally on their own through this period, and then at one point of time in the 14th century, Lal Ded appears on the scene. First viewers, the question about what does Lal Ded mean? It's a new name. It's a name that all of us wonder about as to what it means. And there are one or two interpretations. One simple interpretation is that she's a kind of a granny, a dadi. And Lal then would be the older or the senior Dadi or something like that. And the other interpretation is that Lal is something to do with abdomen or stomach, the size of the stomach. And one of the scholars, has said that she had at some point of time, particularly when she was senior and she was moving around as a saint, then her abdomen protruded. And it covered the lower part of the body because she walked naked, and even a woman, she wouldn't bother about covering herself, and therefore she would walk naked. But then her body, her abdomen protruded, and then, you know, that's what they said, you know, Lal means the abdomen, and Ded means the woman or the mother figure. So one can, you know, this is a kind of convention in India that people generally refer to people by their appearance, that black one, that white one, that brown one, that tall one, that short one. So somebody might have started saying about this saint that, you know, that particular Ded, that particular woman, that particular mother or you know, grandmother who has a big stomach, a big abdomen. Maybe that's how she was described. But so far as she is concerned, she won't bother about this or that name. For her, names didn't matter. I think she was a precursor to Shakespeare, who said what is in her name. And she won't bother about this name, but she had a name once when she was young. And that name that was given to her is Lalleshwari. So maybe from there also Lal has come, who knows. And she was married very early in life. I think around the age of 10 she got married. And she went to the, she perhaps refused to go to the home of the father, of the husband. Or if she went there, then she stayed there for a few months and then she left the home. And then she resisted, she protested against whatever, you know, marriage ceremonies were supposed to be observed. And which means that this is one of the first, you know, critics of marriage, one of the first critics of marriage in India, who doesn't want to, you know, fall into this particular mode of marriage. And she might think, you know, that this comes in the way of her, not merely freedom, but also progress. She wants to progress, she wants to develop as an individual, and matrimony might come in the way of that particular thing. Matrimony might prove to be an obstruction to the mental, spiritual development that Lalleshwari would have. She is born in a Brahmin family, an upper caste, you know, in Kashmir, but then she doesn't bother about caste superiority or caste difference, which is remarkable. Our viewers, even today, we can't get out of the caste mold, but there have been people in India and in far north, people like Lal Ded, saints, and born in the high caste, and they won't bother about caste at all, and they would in fact all their lives preach something that works against the logic of caste. So this kind of a figure we are now confronting as a poet. Now regarding her poetry, she generally wrote in what is called within quotes sentences. Sentence in Sanskrit is vakya, or in Kashmir it can be vak, V-A-K, V-A-A-K or V-A-A-K-H. And you know, if you have heard the word in English, sentence, then this word is Elizabethan, and before also it is used, that if somebody talks very, very hollow and, you know, repetitively, then one can say, oh, he is being sententious. If somebody is moralist and goes on, you know, propagating moral ideas, then somebody says, oh, he is sententious. Which means that if you speak sentence after sentence, then you become sententious. But in Kashmir and in Indian language associated with Kashmiri, you would always say, oh, she is telling us vak. She is telling us sentences. Sentences means statements of wisdom. So this is how I also interpret, you know, vak. Vak is a vakya, and it's a brief statement. And when I thought of this brief statement called vak, which generally has four lines in her case, so she writes most of her poems in four lines only, confines herself to the use of four lines alone. So I straight away thought of the couplet by the bhakti poets like Kabir and others. So vak would be just joining of two couplets and becoming a full statement. And this is a literary genre that was quite popular in Kashmir. And she was writing, she was using this particular literary form called vak. So she is known for her vaks, that means statements of truth and wisdom. So truth and wisdom is important. It's not a statement to tell you what is wrong and right, because that will pull you into the area of morality. But to tell you what is there, what I see is there, what I believe is there. And because I am, says the poet, would say the poet, because I have seen the world longer than you, therefore you have to perhaps trust me, because it's a piece of wisdom. So it's a truth and a wisdom based on experience that I am conveying to you, a person like, saint poet like Lal Ded would say to you.
Sir, sorry to interrupt you, but I wanted to ask you, was this a form of writing her own? Was she who primarily used it, or were there any precursors using Marx in her period?
This information is very, very, very difficult to get. But because she has popularized Marx, so word is associated with her. But definitely, there will be a tradition. In any case, when one confronts a saint, then they generally speak very briefly. So they don't preach. Saints don't preach. Preachers are there, propagandists are there, people who have used the discourse as a method. They talk on and on. But poets and saints together, when the combination occurs, then they just say a few things and go away. And then you are just left wondering. So walk me this, and the question is very valid. I think most the research should be done into this. I consulted a few books where people have not gone into this question of the history of the walk. But I'm sure that if this kind of a thing is popular in Kashmir, with her name associated with it, then many others also would have taken inspiration from her. And she also would have taken inspiration from somebody.
Others.
After all, she didn't learn from her own, but from the existing conventional, speech, etc. And there would have been. This is like in the Indian family, and Kashmiri family would be in touch with the larger Indian family also. The elderly people always say, "Oh, listen to me, I have to say one or two things to you." So that's generally a sentence or two. Always speak the truth, never tell a lie. With one vakya, with one sentence, thing finishes. So maybe, this is all guesswork. In fact, what I've said about her life also is based on hearsay.
Right.
So, but I think, as you have rightly asked this question, this should be a popular form. Maybe not two sentences, may not be, maybe it's five sentences or two sentences only, dohas and all. So, this thing is to be, I think, probed further, and whenever information is there, then one should, establish a specific kind of history,
sir,
of this. So, this is, I'll be doing this myself as I go back to my study of Lal Ded and Kashmiri literature.
Sir, just the way Meera's life is a part of Bhakt, Navadas's Bhakt Mal or any other hagiography, could we find a record of Lal Ded in any such
I don't think that there is any reference in the books that I have read, people who would have, charted her life. But then the legend has grown. And there is a scholar called J.L. Call. He has done some work on this. I also consulted Ayappa Panikkar, from where I'll be, who is a South Indian scholar. And there is another Pillai from Malayalam again. And he also, talks about the Bhakti tradition. But then this extensive research has yet to be done, I believe. Or maybe if I were conversant with Kashmiri writing, or in Kashmir, then I would be able to tell better. But at the moment, I'm only at the introductory stage. And in the meantime, I'll be working on this and getting back, whatever. Definitely, some people would have written about her because she became a legend. And that's why we are today, reading her in English translation. So the query about Vak, that query would be that, the first query would be, what is a Vak? Give us an example. So I give you an example as to what Vak is. I just give this. Whence I have come and by which way? It starts with a question. It starts with a question, which is also a statement. From where have I come? And which was the way I adopted to reach here? And then see the next line, I do not know. So it starts with admission of ignorance. Whither I shall go and by which way, I do not know. So I do not know is the refrain of the Vak. So two sentences. Third is, were I to know the end of it all and gain the knowledge of truth. And then the last line, it will be well for otherwise. Life here is but an empty breath. If I come to know, then I'll realize that life is without any meaning. I think it's more poetic than preachy, or than a preaching kind of a practice. Because the saint directly is telling others that she doesn't know. And that she doesn't know where she came from, she doesn't know where she'll go. And the and when she has known the knowledge of truth, then she will realize that life here means in this world, in my time, is an empty breath. So this is a very good starting point. This is a very genuine, earnest statement of admission that a human being generally does not have any knowledge, and when he has the knowledge, then he realizes that life is meaningless. Very existential. If one comes back to the 20th century, this is what the existentialists would say in the 20th century. But then somebody who doesn't believe in existentialism at all, who is a saint and who will give us some kind of a positive picture, then this person in the 14th century is telling us that we have to take away all the information from us and talk about life in its truthful form. So I'm really moved by this kind of a statement by a saint in the 14th century. India is known for a large number of people who can be called Mr. Know-all. They know everything. But here is a great poet who says she knows nothing. And in fact, when she would come to know something about life, then she might reach the conclusion that life itself is meaningless. just see that in this particular case, the emphasis is on search. When I have searched, then I will know. So it means all life will be given to the tendency of searching. The other important is urge to know. She wants to know. So she has not lost faith in life, even though it's meaningless. Finally, she will realize that life is an empty breath. Even then, she would always want to know the truth about life. So this is the urge to know. This is childlike innocence. The child will never close one's eyes easily. Would always look around and wonder and ask questions and wants to know more and more. And if you tell the child, this is the case, this is the information that you should have in mind, then the child will start asking further questions about the given information. And lastly, the important thing which I have explained, admission of failure, which requires great moral courage. So these things are striking in this case, and I thought I'd share these things with you. Then I give you another example of Vak. This is a famous one. This is also in the course of certain universities. By the highway I came, but by the highway I return not. What does highway mean here? Highway is the path that people generally adopt. When all of us have accepted a path as to be the established path. So I came by this highway, but I will not go back. By this highway. Why is the poet so very apprehensive and suspicious about the worth of the highway? Well, most of the people who tell us about the highway are the Brahmins, and they talk about this is morality, this is truth, this is the path you should adopt. That's the highway. But then, for the genuine seeker of truth, the established path is not the highway. Established path may be serving the interests of the powerful in society. So the powerful people will say, well, do this and don't do the opposite. But then the saint will do the opposite, because the saint knows that this particular path which is being suggested to me for following, this path actually has been created by, produced by and maintained by the powerful section of society, and therefore there may be something dubious about it. It might be serving their interests, but it may not be serving my interests as a common person. This is what the statement is. So I believe it's a very rebellious kind of a statement by a woman poet who otherwise would be totally helpless. That I came by the highway path, but I will not return by the highway. And so I find me still on the embankment. Well, that's the truth. You are on the embankment. You are on the periphery. You are in a corner. You have not even entered the world. And so if you are near a river, then go into the river. Just feel, see, realize the flow of water in the river. But if you are standing on the embankment, then there is a word in Sanskrit or Hindi which is very correct for this kind of a thing. Then we are tatastha. Then we are standing on the bank. Tat ke upar khade hain. So tatastha means detached. because you are detached, because you are away from the water in the river. So she doesn't want this kind of a tatastha position, and she would say, perhaps she is suggesting that she would enter the water and feel its flow and its power. And having gone even half the way, she has to cross the, now the real bhakti, you know, the metaphor comes. The sansara is a kind of a river, and one is supposed to cross and go to the next side. And she says that I am standing on the bank and I have not even covered halfway. I am supposed to cover the full way. Or maybe when I leave this world, by that time I will be still standing on the bank, looking at the water, and won't have the courage to enter it. And the day is done. Most of my life is gone, says the poet. The light has failed. Light has failed, it has lots of meanings, and one literal meaning would be that it's dark, it's evening. The day is done, the light has failed. I search my pockets, but not a kauri find. Kauri is the cheapest thing in life. The conch shells, you know, that are left by water, in the tide, on the seashore. So these shells are left. They are kauris, and anybody can go and collect as many kauris as one wants, but they don't turn into currency. So in a way, this is a phrase from Hindi or whatever, that I don't even have a kauri, which means nothing. What shall I pay for the ferry fee? Now, another question. You have to cross the river. You require a ferry to cross it. And the ferry wala, the person who plies the boat, this person will ask for money. And I don't have the money. Which means that I am doomed now to remain on this side of the river, doomed to stand on the bank, and would never be able to cross it. So this is the kind of experience that the saint wants to share with the audience. And if the saint is admitting this kind of a failure, then one can imagine the plight of the people who are listening to her. So this kind of humility, this kind of boldness, this kind of courage, etc., is really remarkable. And she is not showing any, she is not talking about any God, she is talking about this world. She is talking about some essence that she is looking for in life. But that what that essence is, she doesn't want to share it, because that will come through experience. And experience is of entering the water and going to the other side of the river. So I, by way of comment, say, and the day is done, the light has failed, is poetic. It gives to so many different interpretations that the light has failed. Maybe my own life has come to naught. Maybe I don't have energy left now. Maybe I have grown old, says the poet. So when the sun sets, so there is a, metaphorically, the sunset also represents the state of mind of the speaker who thinks that his innings is over. So the light has failed. It evokes the state of mind. You know, once again, in a statement, in a sentence, generally you want to convey wisdom to the people, or a statement or some kind of an opinion to the people. But you generally don't talk about the state of mind. That this is what I feel, the emotional position, as also an aspect of experience and realization. So one really appreciates this kind of power in the writer, that she is not talking about opinions, she is not talking about moral principles. In fact, she is talking about what she sees in front of her, what is going on in her mind. She is laying bare the state of mind for the reader to see. For the hearer to understand, and this shows that she has rare poetic excellence, and for a bhakti poet who should talk about bhakti, and she's talking about the personal experience, and in fact this is supposed to be containing the idea of bhakti than people who say okay do this and worship God or not God. But she says, well, I don't know anything, and at the same time, I don't have anything with me. So this is the second walk, viewers, and now you have some idea of what walk does to poetry, to statement, to sharing, to the interest of the audience. And I'll take one more example of a walk by her, because that will offer another insight into this thing. And I would maybe waiting some questions from you regarding these two works. What is your opinion about these works?
Strike me as really interesting in the sense that since we have discussed another woman bhakti poet, Meera, I am constantly trying to make a comparison between the two, and I am trying to say that she seems to be asking for nothing, that she has no demands that she wants to be in, put in contact with the so-and-so Lord. And she is in fact also not making a request or imploring people in general also to learn something and so on. But she is basically telling people that I don't have anything and that I don't know anything. And she is very humble in that sense.
And apart from this, she's also sharing a very, very a deep sense of wisdom.
Absolutely, sir.
This comes from with experience. That somebody has seen the world and found nothing in it, and that one is admitting failure. That my job was to cross the river, still sitting on this, standing on this side.
So this interesting idea you shared that sansar is the river that you must cross and go over to the other side to have a spiritual experience. That is an essential part of life that one must experience. And I'm hoping that probably in some works of hers, she talks about her spiritual experience, that she is able to achieve one or establish a link.
Let us see, because she will be talking about those works also. But see how she is able to capture her own world. She has taken the metaphor of the river.
Taken
the metaphor of the boat. Now you already have a river. And in Kashmir, you already have a lake in Kashmir, and people generally use the boat to cross over to the other side. So she is able to see all these things directly, and she is lifting them from there for poetic use.
Absolutely, sir.
And so the life around her with its specific details becomes also a metaphor of life.
Absolutely.
So that way, one or the other, that gets fused with this.
Sir, I was also wondering that it would have been interesting if we knew what age, like say when she wrote such a work, how old she was.
Well, specifically this cannot be said, but she started writing at the age of 20 or so. She left home, I think around 15, and she didn't go back to her parental home either. She had been married into a family, and she didn't abide by the rule of the family. So she left, and then she went into a forest. And there she worshipped. And there she sat in some kind of a state of concentration, in some kind of meditation. And some people started, suspecting her, moral position, that this woman is going to meet someone there, and she is a married one and all. So she was also accused of this. But finally, people realized and they found out that she had gone to just meditate there. So after that, she never stayed at one place. And I don't have much idea about these saints, whether they actually wrote or they spoke, did somebody take these things down. So this is an area, which has to be still worked by the scholars made her copies, who preserved the texts, who finally gave them over to somebody. This is a very, very vast area.
True,
I think I was telling about Kabir, who belongs to the 15th, 16th centuries, that Kabir's poetry wouldn't have been available to us in its purer form if Guru Granth Sahib was not there. Those great gurus, they put his verses there. And then, in the 19th century, there is a revival of Kabir. Till that time, Kabir Panthi would be knowing certain things about him, and people would be just singing his songs. But otherwise, there is no textual evidence to suggest that she or somebody else wrote and when it wrote.
Yes.
So in fact, that's an impossible question to ask as to at what stage somebody wrote a particular this thing.
But, so this convey a sense of maturity that may come.
That's an excellent guess. That's an excellent guess.
Yes.
Because she says, "I'm still standing," which means she already stood there for some time. So it must be, and she lived not more than 40, 45 years. I think the date is 1384, so 54 years. So she would be writing this around 40 or so.
True.
When she has come to know that there is nothing to know. As a young person, one cannot say this. So these questions actually have to be asked, and they are very relevant questions, and they are challenges for scholars. But I wonder how one has to go back to the 14th century to get all this. So I then go to the third one, and all these questions emanate from the actual, you know, text that we are doing to understand the poet. Now, this is actually four lines. Earlier lines were broken sometimes, but they were actually four lines earlier too. In life, I sought neither wealth nor power. This seems to be an earlier one, or maybe later one. Everyone doesn't know the earlier one, since she is talking about that phase when people were putting pressure on her to acquire power and acquire money, and live a good, you know, life in the household. And she says, I wouldn't do this. I don't accept your principles of, you know, earning and preserving, etc., saving. In life, I sought neither wealth nor power. It can also belong to the later part, because she said, I never did earlier. But important thing is that in life, the significance of wealth, money and power, status, that is minimized. And she actually holds a mirror up to us today. Likely acquisitions have to be power and money. Ask anybody, and any middle class young man or woman today, what is your aim in life? And they would say, well, lot of money and lot of power. But then this lady in the 14th century is telling people that she doesn't want wealth or power, nor ran after the pleasures of sense. This is important. There is a clear line of distinction between her, you know, aspirations and those of a woman like Meera. So no pleasure of sense. Which also, you know, it's an English translation. One wishes that, you know, one new Kashmiri. Now this also, you know, leaves a window open to the pleasure of some other kind. So she said that I didn't have pleasures of sense. Then what pleasures did she have? Then she can say I have the pleasures of mind, and the pleasures of thought. Maybe I got satisfaction by thinking about certain areas. Maybe I wanted to understand the truth, and then through different, you know, interpretation of the truth, I realized that one was perhaps more acceptable. So other pleasures, not the pleasure of sense. Moderate in food and drink. This is mystical. So not very spicy food, and drinks will not be intoxicated or intoxicating, or they will not be taken for pleasure. And then she says, I lived a controlled life. This is the life of a yogi. A Shaivite would like to live this kind of a life. She was all the time, you know, having that posture in which his eyes are half closed, and as if, you know, he's concentrating. So this, you know, life of an ascetic, that is what is chosen by her for living. Patiently bore my lot. I didn't hurry things. I remained patient while I was going through agonies. And a lone woman, an unprotected woman, a woman who is a rebel, with whom everybody is feeling inimical, because she has left home. She left her parental home. She left the other home, and she came away, and she stopped wearing clothes, and then she would not observe any rituals, etc. And if people attacked her, some people, you know, we have this tendency in the villages and small towns, even today, that if somebody of this kind, then they start even pelting stones at them. So whatever punishment she might have undergone for this kind of behavior, she says, I patiently bore my lot, my pain and poverty. So she remained in pain. Pressures on her were great, and she was poor. But then in poverty, she was able to, see a purer, a truer sense of love. And then the last word is really amazing, and love God. So this loving God means what? She doesn't want the pleasure of sense. She is not going into trances. She is talking as a normal person. And she's counting, I'll not do this, I'll not do that, I'll not earn money. And after that, she comes to the conclusion. Is there something that you'd like to say on this?
Like you said, she's living a really spiritual life, in that sense that she eats controlled, her diet is controlled, and also she's very calm and composed. I think it also goes in with a lot of discourse that is going on nowadays, that one needs to follow almost the life of a yogi to live a balanced, controlled life. I think in that time she's conveying these ideas is that
How do you interpret and love God after all this? She will not have power, she will not have wealth, she will not have pleasure, she will not have good food, she will not have good drink, and she will love God. Now what does it mean? Tell me what you feel, because I would tell you, and I already told you what I felt.
Absolutely, sir. I would say that in all the three works we have read, the first time she mentions God, and her God is a very universal God in that sense that she is not referring to a specific God, but she perhaps is then pursuing God in that sense, not just talking about spiritual things or preaching things, but she's perhaps showing her devotion towards a certain God.
This is one interpretation. I would broadly agree with it, but I am raising a question before myself. The question is, loving means having an emotion. Loving means enjoying something. Loving means feeling engaged with it. Loving doesn't mean that you are forcing yourself to, or one is forcing oneself to love God. What one is saying is that I didn't like any of these things, but I liked one. That was God, whom I loved. So in a way, she is giving a shock. So it's a poetic shock, and it's what critical phrase will say. It's a shock of recognition. When the shock comes, then you realize that some great point has been conveyed. So I'll not do this, etc., and I'll love God. So suddenly, once one starts thinking, what does she mean? She doesn't love any of these things, and she loves God. So there must be something hidden in it. And the hidden thing is that if you love God, if one loves God, then one doesn't require all these things. So this is the kind of mysticism that you are talking about. That the real truth lies in concentrating on the essence of life, not on eating, drinking, and having money, etc. So there is something called real truth, and there is something called the accepted, largely popularly validated truth. So there is a difference between the two, and she is conveying this very philosophical idea in very clear and precise terms. In fact, I wrote down these three words here in order to talk about this, that she has in this particular walk clarity, crispness, and sense of conviction. Conviction is she is convinced completely that this is what she says, and this she accepts as the truth. So the truth is that one should keep away from all these paraphernalia, all these superficial things, and talk only about that essence which will join us with the activities of life. Now, in the last 10 minutes or so, I'll share certain opinions about this poet by one as I mentioned.
Just a quick observation on what you said. I found this very interesting that you pointed out that she is talking about things that I don't do this and I don't run after pleasure. But at the end, like you said, she just immediately shocks the reader that, and I still love God. And then it makes the reader want to go back to what she has written or said, that why did she say this at the end, and what is the reason for that? And like you already sir mentioned, that it is when you love God, you don't need all these things, that you don't need to run after pleasures of sense or food or drink. So I think that it is a characteristic feature in her work that she wants to alert the reader at some point, that in case the reader feels that he or she is listening to somebody just preaching in a general sense, she tries to give a larger message at the end.
This is the aesthetic point you have raised now. Earlier we were talking about the intellectual content of the literary genre, but in this case it's around the walk that this kind of thing goes on. So the walk in fact gives her a chance to put a question very sharply, and it's a four line statement, and after that one can leave people wondering about this. So this is the aesthetic of Vaagh. And in India, you have the aesthetic of Doha, you have the aesthetic of Ghazal in the case of the 18th, 19th century popular Urdu Ghazal, where the aesthetic is that in 10 or 15 verses, you'll be able to complete the whole thing. And within that, I'll come to that when I discuss Ghalib. But so far as Vaagh is concerned, this is the precise point, that you are using a poetic technique through which a simple idea is presented in all its glory. And that's what she has done. So this is a very good observation that you've given. And now let me, I also noted down something. If I'm able to get it here, then I'll get back to this idea of aesthetics of work. You know, the point where you know some kind of harmony, some kind of effective, you know, phrase has been put forward. Now, one part of the question that you asked, Urvashi, is answered by J.L. Call in one of his statements that I quote, "Saints and missionaries who came from foreign lands, this period saw also the soil and strongly influenced by the local tradition." This is the history of the saint poet, but this is a very, very broad kind of a history. Saints and missionaries came from foreign lands. They were Muslims, as I said in the beginning. And this period also saw the soil and strongly influenced by the local tradition. So the poet was between the local tradition and the teaching of saints who came from outside. So one can perhaps go to those saints, their time frame, and when she might have heard or met a particular saint. Now that can determine, you know, the broader pattern of time, and can go into the history. But this is left for the scholar. And one important statement that Call has also made is that Sanskrit lost the state patronage and Persian came gradually to occupy its status. This also happened in Kashmir. Initially, this was the hegemony of Sanskrit, which means Brahmins, but then that was refuted by the other you know, linguistic patterns that came from Persia. And the Persian language was more and more in use. as I said, she belonged to a high class family, and the other information is that she the parents were well-to-do, so it was not a poor household to which she belonged. Call has also referred to the village Pandrethan, which is 65 kilometers from Srinagar, which has been named the village where she was born. Married when 12 years, not 10, as I said, married when 12 years into a Pandit family of Padmapura and was renamed Padmavati. This is the original name. Accused of infidelity to her husband. This I have already explained.
Yes,
Other points I have made already, and I'll just take three main reasons. One says, this I have explained again. I think for our purpose, I'll just give you one more flock. Maybe that you know takes us to a different aspect of the truth. I refer to this flock because here the humanistic elements are supposed to be represented. And you were talking about the spiritual thing earlier, you know, what kind of spiritual thing she finally reached. This walk, I think, is going to serve that purpose. You are the firmament, you are the earth. This is a different kind of walk. And you would be perhaps God. She will not name God very, very directly, but she will talk about the phenomena, and the phenomena is somehow seen as personified. You is the person. You are the firmament, you are the earth, you are the day, the night, and the wind. The hallowed corn, sandal, flower, and water, evening is you, what is there to be offered to you. You are everything, you means God. You are wind, you are water, you are earth, you are this and that. And finally, if I have to offer, people generally offer something to God. So God has everything, and you take from God and offer to Him. So this is ridiculous. So in a way, once again, attacking that kind of worship, that kind of offering, which Brahmins, for instance, would like you to do in the course of your life. That whenever you have to please God, then you take something and you offer it to God. And she says, "What do I offer? The whole thing belongs to God." And this, if a couple of hundred years later, Kabir would say, he also said, तेरा तुझको सौंपते क्या लगे है मोर, सब कुछ तेरा ही है, तो तेरा तुझके, how can I take anything from this world which is not yours? So just see that, and this, as you were asking about earlier, this seems to be the statement that the poet would make towards the end of her life. Well, here, so she has reached that wisdom where the whole universe is unified, and in this unification, the human being also is a part, and the human being from being a part is actually thinking of offering, has the gumption to offer something to God, which belongs to God Himself. So that kind of a thing. She is not explaining to us the nature of God, etc., except that He is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent, etc. But apart from that, she is not saying anything about what she is saying about the state of ignorance of the people who are offering these things to God. So with such wide expanse of knowledge, she reaches the audience in the simplest form of language that is available to us, and she is then when she makes the point, then she is giving us wisdom and a vision. She is giving us not an opinion. She is giving us some kind of a central thought, and on the basis of that central thought, then we can interpret reality on our own.
Right, absolutely. So this is a very interesting thing you said. She's not giving us an opinion, she's giving us wisdom. So she's not saying don't do this, do that, but she's giving us wisdom in that sense. And that also connects with the idea of granny, sir, that yes, she's giving us the wisdom. Mm. Yes, that's very interestingly put, sir. And friends, with this we draw to the close of our lecture. We do not have any more time left for discussion on this, but of course a very constructive and fruitful discussion we had on Lal Ded, and I did not even realize how the time passed by, and we were just reading her works all the way. So thank you so much, sir, for being here and talking to us about Lal Ded. And friends, we have more to have in our series on writing in India, which we shall be having in our next month. So with this, I'd like to again thank the viewers. Thank you for watching. Have a nice day.